where the thugs them camp at. 2 pounds within a van back. It in a your handbag, your knapsack, it in a your backpack. The smell of the your girlfriend contact. Some boy not know this.
Can I go in? Georgie, can I go in?
Yeah,
I'll make one.
That's why they had you, huh? From Mourinho and Carlos Alberto, and everyone always going forward.
Everybody was good, man. You
remember that movie where he scored?
Alright, so,
we're
gonna protect
and it's always a pleasure to have you back here. You know, you're a son of the soil, so to speak. And you're here on the football business. We could expect a lot of you involved with football in the Caribbean over the next few weeks. Tell us a bit about it.
Well, it will be at the start of the new year. I'm here obviously it's the launch of the Digicel, directed by Digicel, to try and give opportunities to the best young players in the Caribbean. And what we're actually doing is, in the beginning of January to the middle of February, I'll be going to 7 of the Caribbean islands, Ghana, Suriname, Trinidad, Barbados, Antigua, Jamaica, and running clinics, 5-day clinics, with the under 20 teams of those countries, and then shooting players, a player from each country, or the best players that I feel and the coaches feel, to then come to Sunderland, of all places, which is a Premier League team, to have a week's experience of playing at a professional club. So I'm here specifically just for these 2 days, because this is obviously the launch of it, but practically we'll be starting the campaign and the program in January.
All right. Specifically the reason for Caribbean talent, we see obviously that, you know, the Caribbean has, you know, a lot of talent at its disposal. It's untouched, so to speak, and we now have a chance to come out and hit some of the talent.
Well, if you see what happened in Africa 20, 30 years ago, when a lot of people were slow to recognize the talent in Africa, England particularly was slow to recognize it, because while they already had European scouts, French, Belgian, German scouts in Africa, this is an untapped market. And we can see from 98 with Jamaica qualifying for the World Cup, Soca Warriors from Trinidad qualifying for the last World Cup, Kenwyne Jones obviously from Dwight Yorke's day. You see there's a lot of talent coming out, but it needs to be harnessed and it needs to be given an opportunity. And in England now, they recognize the fact that, you know, although Africa is saturated, this is now the next place where you're going to get the talent coming out to maybe, hopefully, grace the Premier League. Well, if you look at what's happened in the Caribbean, from even before Jamaica qualified in the World Cup, we talk about the last 15 years, and the success of this region, financial and otherwise, not just on the playing field, is down to Jack Warner, because Jack really has put the Caribbean on the map. And everyone in Europe, which is the stronghold of world football, if you like, recognizes although FIFA is world governing body, but even people in Europe will recognize the role that Jack has played in bringing on football in this region. America has benefited from Jack Walker. The great America has benefited. So, you know, football has changed. It is business now. And once upon a time, people were being exploited, particularly in Africa. And of course, with someone as powerful as Jack Warner, he will ensure that the players and the associations of this region, where once upon a time may have been exploited, will now not be exploited, and they will benefit from having Jack on board.
All right. And obviously, in recent times, he's been linked with a lot of talk with regards to 2018 World Cup and England's bid and England's possibilities. What are your feelings on this?
Well, 2020 is a long way away, you know, and I'm a believer, and the world has changed, and Sepp Blatter has, you know, once you saw the World Cup went to South Korea, now it's going to South Africa. It is the World Cup, and I believe it should be rotated, and I believe regardless of whether, you know, obviously it has to be financially viable, they have to be able to cope with it in any particular region, but I'm not an elitist to think that it has to go to the best teams in Europe, or the best countries in Europe, or the countries with the best stadiums in Europe. So, you know, I would like it to continue to be rotated in a way whereby it goes from continent to continent.
All right, and looking forward to the next qualifying campaign. We look at the CONCACAF group in particular, Jamaica, Trinidad and Tobago. Again, they're going to try to represent the Caribbean. We can't forget the Haitians. Obviously, you've kept an eye on what has taken place here in this region.
Well, you know, from a positive perspective for the region, the fact that Haiti, Cuba, a lot of these teams now are much better than they were, means that it is good from a perspective of a lot of the countries in the region now can compete at the highest level. It's bad insofar as it's going to be harder for Jamaica and Trinidad and, you know, the West Indies teams, if you like, the West Indian teams, to qualify because they have much stronger opposition. But the fact that the level has risen in this area shows how strong the region actually is. And I think that Jamaica probably fell behind a bit after qualifying in 98. We expected them to qualify since, and they haven't. Trinidad qualified in the last World Cup, and I think that they should learn from Jamaica's experiences to know that, okay, they did qualify, but there's still a lot of hard work to be done to ensure that they have qualify again and again. And with the players now being given exposure in England and in Europe, as the Jamaican players have, there's no reason why we can't see both of those countries from the West Indian point of view, if you like, you know, making a claim to qualify for the next World Cup.
All right, great. Let's revert back to you on a personal note a bit. You know, remember your days at Liverpool, you're a legend, you're still a living legend, so to say. And in particular, now we see, you know, the need, not possibly the need, but the lack of black managers in the UK. And how do you feel about this?
Well, there is, and that is an obvious situation, as you did mention. And I liken black managers in the UK to black footballers in the UK in the 70s. When you're a black player in the UK in the 70s, you were either a winger or a centre forward, because of the stereotypical view that people had of you. You're not particularly intelligent, so you can't think that much. So let's not put you in a defensive midfield responsibility or a goalkeeper or centre-back. You're fast, you're quick, you don't have to think too much, get on the wing. And that was a stereotype that black players had in the 70s. Obviously, 30 years later, those myths and stereotypes have been dispelled. So you have black goalkeepers, black centre-halves. So they still have this theory that, you know, if you're black, you know, do you have the intelligence to be a coach? You can be a youth team coach, you can be a reserve team coach, could you be a top coach? So therefore, we still have those stereotypes about black managers, if you like, to overcome. But hopefully, as time goes on, and Paul Ince has now got in and he's managing in the lower divisions, they have one or two, but, you know, we do need more. And it's something I would love to do. You know, I was at Celtic for a while and I would love to get back in, but all you can do is just keep trying.
And you in particular, tell us a little bit of what you're actually involved in these days.
Well, these days I work in the media, I work in television. Fortunately, I'm still involved in football, because for Channel 5, who I work for in England, we do the UEFA Cup and we do the Italian football. So I'm a television presenter and a media pundit, but I'd much rather be involved on the ground. So hopefully it will land somewhere.
And if the opportunity by some means is presented from this region, would you consider that?
I would consider anything. I mean, I've been in Africa in the last 6 months speaking to some of the African countries about the possibility. But of course, you know, anywhere, because, you know, football is, and from this region particularly, it gives you an opportunity, because the football is so strong in this region that coming here once upon a time, you couldn't really help in terms of getting to qualify for the World Cup or to make a name for yourself. Whereas the football has improved so much here that it is an attractive proposition. You have Terry Fenwick here for many years, and it's an attractive proposition. And Jamaica is similar, you know, so if an opportunity presents itself, I would look at anything.
All right, great. We wish you the best.
Thank you.
It inna your handbag, your knapsack, it inna your backpack. This melody your girlfriend contact. Some boy not know this. Them only come around like tourists on the beach with a few club sodas, bedtime stories, and pearls like them name Chuck Norris. And don't know the real hardcore, cause sandals are no back to the thugs. Them we do where them got.